Hello there. Can you hear me from this mic? Fantastic. And I love it that I didn't have to ask you to repeat it. How about the back? All good? Awesome. So I like to walk around. I'll do my best not to, because there's a part of me that's always like, you know, there's going to be a time when you do it and you're going to trip. Everybody's going to laugh. Did everybody see? I don't know if you saw Holly Berry on stage. If you didn't, go look on like YouTube or a video. Holly Berry like fell across the floor. It was the funniest thing. She's fine. So she fell across the floor and I'm always like, that might be me one day, so maybe I need to stay put. Thank you again for the warm introduction and for allowing me to come forth. Paul mentioned that the last time, or the time when he did hear me speak, that he was emotional, and I do my best not to cause that. However, I realize that in hearing some of the stories and the personal experiences of anyone who's been trafficked or experienced sexual trauma or violence in any way, it's hard to hear. So I do want to acknowledge, and I always try to start with an acknowledgement of the same as Paul, if anyone has a moment where you're experiencing any sort of pain in hearing this, feel free to exit, feel free to let me know, and I too will be available to speak with you afterwards, because I realize that sometimes there are survivors in a room that don't even realize they are surviving. Or there are survivors in a space that don't realize that what they've been through was survival. And sometimes you hear a message and it resonates and reminds you of your own personal experiences. So I do want to offer that before we get started. So a lot of the work that I've done over the years has been around healing and understanding the importance of speaking in front of groups and telling your story over and over again, and how very difficult it may be. And so as we move through the day, and even towards the latter part of the day, you're in for an amazing experience, because I'll have an opportunity to sit with the very reason we're here, which is to hear and reflect and understand some of the experiences of survivors. I titled this particular presentation, Not Just a Number. So let me explain a little bit about where I was at when I thought of it. Most of the time when I speak, I used to do, especially when I first got started, I used to do like huge presentations, and most of it was like all my words on the screen, because I knew that it would be uncomfortable for me, or there would be moments when I would forget what I'd want to say or lose my train of thought. Through the grace of God, I've learned how to do this work at least well for me, and that most of the time now when I speak, it truly does come from the heart. There's not a whole lot of preparation. There's a little bit of time to reflect about the message I want to send, but most of the time when I enter spaces, I allow God to speak through me, and I also listen to the energy of a room and allow whatever words I feel like he wants me to share to come forth. And that's what I'll do today. So I did put some notes here, and I'll refer to them. But for the most part, I want it to be very clear that what comes from me truly comes from me. So when I put not just a number, I was thinking about and reflecting on when I first started to get what I would consider some support and help from organizations. And I remember having very, very exceptional experiences, and I remember having experiences that caused additional harm. And I remember going into places and not necessarily being able to articulate what I needed. So a lot of my trauma happened as a child. So my trauma started at the age of 11 and didn't end until I was close to 16. When I reflect on some of those experiences and the things that I went through, what I tell myself all the time now that I'm able to honor what I experienced is that I didn't even realize at the time that what I was experiencing was trauma. What I thought I was experiencing was normalcy. See, my mother was a domestic violence victim. My mother went through sexual trauma. My grandmother went through sexual trauma and violence. My aunt went through sexual trauma and violence. We lost a family member due to sexual trauma and violence. I have cousins who are currently experiencing sexual trauma and violence. So when you hear that, you realize that that's truly how I grew up. That is what I knew, right, wrong, or indifferent, and so it was part of my identity. Now, when I say identity, when you think of yours, you may think of your race, you may think of your sexuality, you may think of your orientation, your culture, your country. My identity was rooted in violence. So as someone whose identity is rooted in violence, you don't have a whole lot of trust for people. You don't have a lot of trust for hope. You don't have a lot of trust in outcomes. You don't have a lot of trust in a future. So as I was navigating all of those things as a youth, what I realized is as my body was tormented, and my mind was tormented, and my spirit was tormented, again, I looked at that as normal. It was just the way it was. And I think about my exceptional woman, isn't an exceptional woman, but my mother was also traumatized. And so a lot of the work I do is helping people understand the alignment between trauma, both historical, both racial, both health disparity, and health disparities, to help you understand they're all interconnected. A lot of us don't want to have those conversations because we don't necessarily see the parallels. But as a Black woman, I can stand here and tell you that much of what I experienced was rooted in violence, was rooted in racism, was rooted in poverty, was rooted in inequity, and it all played a part into the experiences that I had between the ages of 11 and 15. We can't ignore that so many communities are suffering. And I often ask myself, if I had had resources and opportunities, if my mother had had resources and opportunities, if my grandmother maybe had had better resources and opportunities, would I have experienced the trauma and the pain that I did? I can't answer that question. But what I can tell you is part of the work we should be centered on is ensuring no one has those experiences to begin with. Wouldn't you agree?
Yes.
So I think to myself, if I had an opportunity to grow up in an environment that was healthy and healing and wholesome, would I have experienced as much pain? I can't answer that. But isn't it our right to grow up in environments where we don't have pain and hurt and trauma and poverty? I can remember times when we would get up and my mother would always tell me, we can't look like what we go through. And for those that don't understand that, she would always say, you keep yourself together, right? You make sure your hair is done and your clothes are well and you're kept. And I'd always think to myself, but Mom, we barely ate last night. We're sleeping on the floor. We don't have any food. But what I appreciate about my mother, she's not here today. Unfortunately, my mother's usually everywhere I am and I usually call her out at this point. But she broke her foot. She broke her foot and she would have been totally mad. She told me, I am not rolling around on a scooter in that place. So shout out to my mother who would have been here and I would have given her all the honor and glory. But I remember going back, I digress, going back. So my mother would always say to me, you don't look like what you've been through. You don't do that. And while at the time I didn't understand that and I would always get mad at her, what I understand now is my mother was trying to build in me a sense of pride and a sense of dignity, even with my trauma. She was trying to help me understand that even though we are struggling, and even though we are suffering, you will come out on the other side. I didn't see it as that until now. And now dignity is literally embedded into my work. What I want you to understand is that every survivor does not look the same, does not sound the same, does not act the same, and does not heal the same. So when I talk about what healed me, what brought me through, I'm going to name a few things just throughout my experience that I hope you will take as you go out and hopefully do incredible work in this space and share exactly what it is that survivors need. I mentioned a little bit about racial inequities, poverty, health disparities, and how they impact communities. If we are not doing our part to ensure that people are not suffering, we will never get to a point where human trafficking doesn't exist. You heard the saying, hurt people hurt people. I do a lot of work with perpetrators too, and some people are like, whoa. And I'm like, but here's the deal. If I can impact a perpetrator or stop an abuser from going in the direction of so many people that have abused and continue to abuse, that is also the work. That is also the work. So it's not to say that I go into those spaces completely comfortable and that I'm not angry and I'm not hurting, especially when I'm sitting across from someone who's raped a child. What I am saying is part of the research and the work is to understand what made you rape that child. What happened? And most of the time what I hear, I grew up poor, I didn't have anything, I didn't have a good father, I didn't have a relationship with my father, my mother maybe was abusive, my situation was dire, I didn't have a lot, I didn't have a lot of experiences or opportunities. And you know, some folks may look at that as opportunity, excuse. I look at that as fact and truth. And if so many people I hear that from say the same thing, then shouldn't we be listening? That those are real issues. And so many of us don't want to talk about race, and we don't want to talk about health disparities, and we don't want to talk about how that impacts all of us. But what I'm here to tell you is that if we don't start to look at those situations for what they are, we will never get to a point where we will end human trafficking. So I start with understanding the core of why people do what they do. Why do people abuse? Why do people hurt? When I think about my own personal story, and again, I have to tell you, this is is my personal story. It's always important for me to elevate and amplify that every survivor is not the same. Just as you are different, just as we are all unique, so are we. The harm that has been caused is because, unfortunately, people blanket survivors and put us all in this box of discomfort that is completely inaccurate. And guess what? Because that is done, you don't know how to heal us effectively. For me personally, I think a lot of my own experiences were built and surrounded by my family structure. Again, I mentioned most of my family experienced abuse, most of my family lived in poverty, most of my family was surrounded by gang violence, and so quite naturally, that became my normalcy. I also think it is very, very important for us to bring our children up in a way that they feel powerful, they feel dignified, and they feel respected. My self-esteem was so very low because of what I was surrounded by. So it was very easy for me to hear someone tell me, well, if you come over here and do this thing, I'll give you everything you want. And guess what the everything was for me? A pair of tennis shoes. My mother couldn't afford the best shoes. I didn't want to go to school and everybody talk about me. So okay, you want me to do this thing for a pair of tennis shoes? Why not? Feels right. Oh, we don't have enough money to eat. You know what? My mother really needs something on the table. I'll do that for some food. Why not? Oh, my little sister needs Pampers. Why not? There's a part of my story that I often leave out, and I tell it when it feels right to me, and I'll tell it in this moment. I was 14. Laying in the bathtub, and I remember my stomach moved. And my grandmother, rest in peace, my grandmother passed in 2021, she was a beautiful soul. She comes in the bathroom and I say, Grandma, my stomach's moving. I don't know what's going on here. And she looks down and she runs out the room screaming. I'll never forget it. So she goes to get my mother, and my mother comes back and she's like, and she runs out the room screaming. I'm laying in the tub like, what? My stomach's moving. Fix it. Fix it. I was pregnant. And I had gotten so far along in my pregnancy that I didn't even know I was pregnant. Now, mind you, all of my trauma had led me to a place where I didn't even understand what sex was, what intimacy was, what normal menstrual cycles were. So being pregnant was like, well, how did that happen? I don't understand. I remember sitting down with my grandmother and my grandmother saying, we are in such dire straits. If you, obviously she didn't use those words, but she was telling me, you know, things are so hard for us. I don't know what to do. But if you want to have this child, we will figure it out. And my mother and I were driving in the car, and I remember seeing a billboard that said adoption. I told my mom, I'm gonna do that. I wanna do that. And my mother said to me, do you understand what that means? Do you understand you're going to give birth to a child? Do you understand you're going to have to give that child to someone else? Do you understand what that means for your body and who you are? And all I told her was, no, but I don't want to do that. Nothing else feels right. So at the age of 15, I placed my daughter into the hands of someone else and asked God to protect her and keep her and make her better. Fast forward, her name is Chastity Gabrielle Ray Evans. She and I are the best of friends, and I'm a grandmother of two. I often tell Chastity, especially now that we're in a place of understanding experiences and what I gave up to give her life, that she changed me. Not everyone has that form of trauma. Not everyone experiences what I did to change my life. So many people make whatever decision is best for them, but I did what was best for me, and I don't regret it. It's been hard. And as a survivor, having to navigate the experiences of trafficking and rape and trauma and domestic violence, while also navigating having given my daughter daughter to this world, what I realize now in doing this work and caring for our community and caring for our people is that every story is so very, very unique and real and raw that unless you're centering the experiences of survivors, you have no clue how to do this work well. And it took me a long time to understand that that was my power and my purpose, that I have to, I literally cannot not stand before people and help them understand what has brought me out. What has brought me out, first and foremost, has been a lot of love. My mother, through her hardest times, through her most difficult struggles, loved me through it all. When her baby was laying on that table giving birth, I remember my mother going off to the side. And here's the fun, this isn't funny, but it's funny now, right? It's funny in retrospect. So I got chicken pox when I was pregnant. So when you get chicken pox when you're pregnant, you can't have any sort of like stuff. Some nurses and specialists will know. So my pain relief was like minimal. And I'm a baby, right? And I'm like, well, why I can't have the things that you put in the back to stop all the pain, right? And the doctor's like, you have chicken pox and we don't want to risk hurting you. Now times may have changed. This was 20 plus years ago. But then you couldn't do it. And they had to usher me through a back door is the wildest times. But so I had chicken pox and I'm pregnant. So I say all that to say the pain I was in, my mother couldn't handle. Right? So my mother runs out the room and I'm like, but wait, right? And the doctor pulls her to the side and says, you have the most strongest woman, young woman in there, young girl. She's gonna be all right, but I need you to go in there and stand with her. My mother says she straightened up. She literally will act it out. She was here, she went, right? She wipes it off and she comes and stands next to me. And she said, we got through that together. The day that, and it was so fortunate, Chastity's parents were absolutely amazing and a blessing. And when we went through the adoption process, Chastity's parents, beautiful, beautiful, Bob and Linda, I remember when we handed Chastity to them and Linda grabbed me and just told me, I will make you proud. I got her. And my mother stood there with me, right? And I remember every holiday and birthday and season that I would think about her and cry over her and write letters to her, she would hold me. And I fast forward about 20 years later when I was actually sitting and meeting with Chastity. Chastity said, every letter you wrote, they gave me. I read everything. So she knew I loved her and she knew I was there. That's what got her through, right? Love is first and foremost. You want to understand how to court survivors, you love them. You love them without judgment. You love them without condemning. You love us without asking questions we're not comfortable to answer. You just know we've been through it. Love first. The second thing that's gotten me through, especially as I've grown in my career, is the opportunity to center our voices. There's a saying that says there should be nothing for us without us. There should be not one law, not one policy, not one advocacy effort, nothing done in legislature, nothing done at your tables, unless there's a survivor present. If you are speaking about the experiences of a survivor without centering the voice of a survivor, I can promise you, you're not doing this work as well. I remember I was on a call with a bunch of folks for an event for a meeting, and we were talking about child advocacy and human trafficking. And I remember I started to interject kind of an opinion, and one of the people on the call said, well, I'd rather hear from an expert. Excuse me, right? So I remember I said, well, I'll tell you the truth of what I said. This is funny, but not funny. I was so upset, I had a friend in the chat, right? So this is all on Zoom. You can imagine what I did. So I'm chatting her and I'm like, I cannot believe that he said. And I sent it to everybody. It was the best. It was the best. So after it went to the whole group, I was like, well, what's done is done. What's done is done. Thank you, Lord. What's done is done. So he calls me, which is again God's plan. He calls me and he apologizes. And I say, can I just tell you, sir, with all due respect, I admire and respect every degree and level of education you hold. We need you. But dear sir, you need centering the voices of survivors. Survivors belong in any room you're in. Survivors' voices need to be elevated and heard. Do this work with empathy and kindness, but do not placate. And do not treat us as if we are not educated, brilliant, and able to handle anything that you tell us. Because here's the reality. Most of what we've experienced, you could never. And we stand in that, and we should stand in that, and we are proud of that. So the level of experience you have in your world, understand that's the level of experience we bring to yours. So to not handle us with empathy and care, and to instead placate, and to treat us as if we don't have a voice and we don't have an understanding, is not only dismissive, it's disrespectful. There are times I'm in spaces where people make assumptions about me based on a story they may or may not know, and it's the most uncomfortable and most disrespectful thing that I've ever experienced, because I am just as any of you, regardless of what I've been through in my life. Practice empathy, practice respect, and that leads me to dignity. I mentioned earlier that my mother would always say, don't look like what you've been through. And at the time, I didn't understand what that meant. And now when we've talked about it and reflected on it, she's always like, listen, everyone has a level of hardship and experience. Yes, you have been through a lot. We've all been through a lot. But that does not mean you can't hold yourself with esteem and high regard and respect. And it took a while to get there. A lot of mentoring, a lot of love, a lot of empathy, a lot of kindness. But never once did she allow me to lose my dignity. When I gave birth to Chastity, we reflect on it now, and I'm like, well, that probably wasn't right, Mom. But she's like, I made you go back to school. I'm like, well, you probably shouldn't have done that. You know, but again, we understand now, right? Knowing is growing. And so my mother in that moment thought, well, the only way I could think to push you through and move you through your trauma was to throw you back out there. I played tennis, right? I actually went to college on a tennis scholarship, and I was pregnant with Chastity on the court, hiding it with a sweatshirt. Right? So a lot of people only know about Chastity over the last 5 years of my life because we are just starting to tell our story. So I went through high school and junior high, pregnant, playing tennis on the court, right? I wish I could get back to that. Now I can walk up the flight of stairs without back then I was playing tennis, pregnant, right? So I was playing tennis, and I remember my mother telling me, she goes, I know that I didn't handle everything right, and again, I want you to give yourselves grace around how you handle trauma and what trauma-informed care looks like. Because again, my mother was hurt, had been through hurt, had understood pain, so didn't necessarily know how to navigate my own. And that's fair for all of us in this room. But my mother also took the time to educate herself and learn from me and learn from others around what it looks like to support victims and to support survivors. She thought she was doing it right, and I don't fault her for any of it. But to throw me back into life also forced me and made me a person that literally doesn't know how to slow down and handle much. Right? So I'm getting better. But I think that resiliency is good, but also I need just as much love and care as anyone else. So I think understanding that, again, trauma-informed care means doing what is best for that person and what that person needs is part of the work we all need to do. Right? When I talk about trauma-informed, what I mean is sit in this room and listen to the stories you'll hear today. Let them flow through you. Cry if you need to, feel what you need to, but really listen. Not to interject, not to opinion, and not to solution, but to hear us. Take that information and decide, what is it that you can do in your own sphere of influence that can hopefully impact the way this work looks, and also realizing we are not just numbers. We are individuals having human experiences just like all of you. And we deserve the same level of care and comfort just as all of you. I'm gonna look at my notes, but I feel like I'm missing something. And are we close? How's time? Are we good? I have 10 minutes. Shouldn't have told me that. No, I'm just kidding. 10 minutes might become an hour. No, I'm just kidding. Okay. So I started to talk about all the things, and I wanna just hit them. We talked about empathy and active listening. That means slow down long enough to hear what people have to say. Don't assume, don't solution, and don't try to fix it. Ooh, I forgot my voice carries. Y'all didn't say anything. I didn't have my mic on. Survivor-centered strategies, meaning nothing for us without us. If you can just remember that phrase, and I don't know who I stole it from, but it feels right. Nothing for us without us. Collaborative partnerships, that's what I miss. So in my work, a lot of what I do is around working with survivors. Here's the reality. Every survivor can't do this. Every survivor won't be comfortable or feel comfortable doing this. But I always tell people it's no different than advocacy work. Not everybody's going to write. Not everybody's going to protest. Not everybody's going to go to the legislature and fight the bills in Lincoln, right? But everyone finds a way to do the work in the ways that are comfortable for them. Survivors are no different. Collaborative partnerships means a lot of the work I do in my personal business is I go into communities and I go into organizations and I do this. I sit at tables with organizations and help them strategize. I help them figure out what is the best way to navigate this work well. Collaborative partnerships means I don't want to do your job. I want to help you do your job. The main problem with any advocacy work and any work that we try to do in our communities, especially this work, is there's too much ego. And I can say that because I've worked with organizations all across this country, and it's the same issue everywhere I go. Everyone wants to be right, everyone wants the credit, everyone wants the dollar. But here's the deal. The people you're impacting when you're fighting for the wrong things are me and my friends and other survivors. You're not helping us. So the way that you do this work well is you collaborate. You call on survivors. You ask us to sit at your tables. You pay us for the work we do, because this is work. Collaborative relationships means other organizations that are doing something over here can work with an organization like I've Got a Name who's doing powerful work here, and you can be just as powerful together. Collaborative means you're in your churches and you're asking your pastors and you're asking your pulpit to talk about this. Yes, it's hard, but it's necessary. And collaborative means you're actually sitting around your dinner tables having conversations with your family. When I do racial equity work, that's the main question I'm always asked. Well, what can I do? And I go, next time you're at lunch, dinner, sitting with your family, Christmas, have a conversation. It starts at your tables. No one has to feel like they have to do this major thing. A lot of the people who need to hear this message are not in this room. Tell them. When we talk about human trafficking, it exists everywhere. There's not a certain person, there's not a certain background, there's not a certain nationality, there's not a certain culture, there's not a certain level. But I told you, if we don't fix the core, we're gonna have a very difficult problem fixing the mass. If we don't make sure people are well fed and taken care of, and out of poverty, and given resources, and opportunities, and can go to college, and can do all the things that everyone else wants to do and can do, we will continue to see sexual trafficking, we will continue to see racial inequities, we will continue to see all the trauma and domestic violence. It's rooted in something. And until we deal with the roots, we can't deal with it. What can you do there? What can you give? What can you give to keep organizations like I've Got a Name alive? Because we need them. Collaborative partnerships means all of you have a voice in this work. Now that you've heard me speak, you can't in good conscience ignore me, right? So you have to do something to advance this work. And I'm telling you, something could be just as small as you having a conversation with a youth in your family. Because what I'm praying is that someone in your family will not eventually be an abuser. And you have an opportunity to maybe have that conversation and stop that from happening. It's in our families, y'all. It's in our neighbors. It's across the street. It's around the corner. And dare I say it, it's in our churches. We have a responsibility to have the conversation. Say something. Do something. That's what collaborative looks like. The other piece I'll mention is prevention education and legal and policy reforms. When it comes to prevention and education, this is a beautiful space. And I thank you all for being here to just learn and listen and understand all the people and the partners. I'm so excited to hear everyone else speak that are trying to do this work and tackling it from different angles. Because there's different ways this work is happening, and there's different ways that abusers are able to keep it going. So we need to hear all of it so that we understand. Keep educating yourselves, keep learning. Another thing I always say in racial equity work, which is just as applicable here, is that, listen, it is not enough for you to read one book. It is not enough for you to watch one television show. That does not make you educated. Continuously want to learn and understand what this work looks like. I have made myself available because it matters to me that much, that if anyone wanted to call me, have a conversation, email me, talk, I am here. I'm protected. I always joke, God does not play about me. Look at my life. He has kept me. So I stand strong in the work, and I'm here.
Lastly, legal and policy reform. The reality is there are not enough laws protecting us. As trafficking victims, as survivors of domestic violence, there are not enough laws that truly protect us. We were just advocating for a law that actually allows people to, once they try to leave a situation, take their pets, because that's important. Some women won't leave, some people won't leave a situation or leave an environment because they can't take their animal. Or I've been abused, I've gone through the system, I need medical care, and you're gonna make me pay my medical bill. I had to cover the medical bills from a pregnancy that I didn't want. But a daughter that I'm so grateful for, that it's okay. But think about someone else in that situation. You're gonna cause me financial harm for harm I didn't commit? Think about it. Those are the laws we need to be actively working to change. As I close, I'll read kind of what I wrote here, just because I was really thinking about it this morning.
As we stand united against all the injustices that survivors experience, let us remember that the fight is not only for survivors, but for a world that values human dignity above all else. By embracing survivor experiences as a guiding light, we can build a future that is founded on empathy, compassion, and justice for all of us. Let us commit ourselves to amplify the voice of survivors, learn from our experiences, implement transformative change to prevent further harm. I believe together we can create a world where these abuses have no place, and all individuals can live free from fear, exploitation, and abuse. Thank you all so much.